I think it's definitely the most MacGyver-y type of discipline because, yeah, there's just never the exact right thing that you need in that moment. And it's like, well, I think I could connect these two adapters together and it might work. There is a lot of creativity that goes into it, which is also a super fun aspect of it because it's challenging you to think outside the box.
Well, hi, Shannon. Thank you so much for being with us today.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, and you've been a wound care nurse. Can you tell us a little bit about what the specialty of wound care nursing is and what makes it unique from other specialties?
Sure. There are three separate certifications that kind of fall under what people think of when they think of wound nursing. The three, they're grouped together, wound, ostomy, and continence nursing. And they're grouped together because they kind of developed at the same time. A lot of ostomy patients also suffered from skin breakdown around the stoma. So therefore, the wound care became a thing. And then they started to use some of the similar products from ostomy care into treatment of wounds and pressure injuries. And then because continence so closely tied to pressure injuries and skin breakdown, that also was put in. So you can have any different combination of wound, ostomy, continence certification. I started out with all three and have since dropped the continence portion of it just because I'm not really using it in my current position. I just didn't renew the certification. You have to do it every 5 years. And I just didn't feel like it was, I was very pregnant with the third kid at that point and felt like two tests was plenty for my brain and not utilizing the continence portion. I just decided to not renew it at that point. But you can have wound and continence. You can have wound and ostomy, which is the most common, or just wound, just ostomy, just continence. But they're all certified by the same certification board, the WOCN-CB.
With the certification, it's every 5 years you have to retake a test and not just do CEUs.
Yes, there's two options. So there's the PGP, which is the professional growth portfolio, I believe. It's a renewal option. And so with that one, there's points like there are with CEUs for the RN license. However, you have to do like a certain number of points in education. And so you would provide them with PowerPoint presentations that you delivered to a group of nurses about pressure injury prevention, you know, or it encompasses a wide variety of things that you can include in that. And then the other option is to take the exams again. So every 5 years, you have to do one of those two options for every single scope that you have. So you take an exam for wound, an exam for ostomy, or you do the portfolio for wound, the portfolio for ostomy, and then continence as well, if you do that. Okay. So it's either exam or portfolio.
Okay.
And when you first get the certification, it's always the exams. Like for any certification. And it's a different role than bedside primary nursing in that it's more of a consultation position. I see mostly inpatients. So we get consulted from either the physician or the bedside nurses when there is a concern. And then we are seeing the patients in that capacity, similar to a physical therapist or, you know, a physician who comes in, or, you know, we're not taking care of the patient for the entire shift like those, like the primary bedside nurses are. So that's how it's a little different as far as the function and how it's usually set up, but that's inpatient. They're also utilized in the outpatient environment as well.
How did you get into wound care nursing? Like, what made you even think of that as an option? And how did you know it was the right fit for you?
It felt like it just kind of happened. I was working in the surgical ICU as a new grad out of nursing school. And although that was a great experience and I learned a lot very quickly, it was also, I thought that's what I wanted to do for my whole life, you know, in nursing school. I'm like, I'm going to be an ICU nurse. I really want to do that. And I loved it. I did enjoy it, but it's exhausting. And anyone who's worked in ICU or even anywhere bedside nursing can attest to that. It can be very exhausting. And I remember feeling like, you know, I take care of these people when they're so, so sick. And we get them to the point where like, oh, well, they're not dying right now. So we're going to transfer them. And then you never know what happens. You never know if they coded on the floor or if they got better and went to rehab and are walking at home now, or if they ended up in an LTAC somewhere, you never know what happens to them. I mean, with rare exceptions, there are some patients who come back, or family members or whoever that we hear about, but the vast majority of patients, you just don't know what actually ends up happening. Mm-hmm. And that is emotionally exhausting. And then you have the physical exhaustion part of it that goes with any sort of bedside nursing care and being a new grad in the ICU, where you are learning so much so fast. Mm. And I was working night shift those 2 years and knew that this was not something that I could sustain and that I could be just a functional human being.
Yeah.
I was not in a good spot. I mean, people called me Zombie Shannon. That's like, that I was not me. I was not healthy. So I knew that I needed to make a change, but at the same time, I didn't want to rush into anything. Mm-hmm. And I wanted to try to be content where I was as much as I could in the season that I was there and to do a good job at it. And I remember one morning I was sitting right at the end of my shift and one of the wound nurses came in early that day and was seeing patients. And I was like, that's an interesting specialty. And I've always been fascinated by wounds. I think they're gross, but I was always fascinated by it. It's interesting. But I just started researching a little bit about what it would take to become a wound nurse. And I knew that the schedule was a little bit more like a regular job, you know, regular job, not nursing job, where it's more of a 9-to-5 type of thing. That appealed to me because I felt like I was missing out on a lot of the evening activities with my husband's schedule. So I just kind of started pursuing it and decided now's the time to do it. Figured I could get the certification. And even if I stay in my current position, it's not a bad thing, right? I'm learning something new. It's a skill that could be very useful. Even, you know, working in ICU, we see a lot of wounds. That's where people get the most pressure injuries. So I just started going for the schooling and did the coursework. And then as part of the certification program, you have to do clinical hours. So I did that with the department at my facility that I had been working at. And they happened to open up a position in the department right as I was finishing my clinicals. And I had basically just had a working interview for, you know, a few weeks. I was doing my clinical hours and it was a good fit. And they hired me for that position right after I finished my certification.
Was it hard to let go since the ICU was something that you had kind of dreamed about going to for a long time? And that was your goal to then be in your goal and realize it's actually not where you want to be or not a good fit for you?
Yeah. You know, it's interesting because I think there's the mentality that because the ICU is where the sickest patients are, that it's the hardest and the most difficult. And therefore, if you make it to that, then you've somehow arrived at some sort of, I don't know, special level of whatever it might be. And that's not true. Objectively, we know that's not true. Anybody who's worked in a step down or PCU level of care, in my opinion, that's the hardest level of care to be in because you have very sick people and a lot less technology to tell you what's going on. But there is that kind of stereotype of that idea of ICU. I did feel in a sense like, man, am I failing? You know, like I just can't cut it here in the ICU. And I had to just be okay with that. Yeah. I mean, I could make it work. I could struggle and suffer through it, but why am I just trying to prove something to myself or to somebody else that I have what it takes to do it? At the end of the day, no, I didn't have what it takes to stick with it. And I am way happier now. And so I think I just had to get over that idea because it was my goal and because of just the stereotype of ICU nursing that it's okay to not want to do that. It's okay to be there and then to leave it. And a lot of people do. A lot of people start in ICU and go to, you know, outpatient surgery where they're recovering patients after whatever outpatient surgery. It doesn't have to be the end goal. And if you get to ICU and you're miserable, yeah, it's okay to leave. It's okay to leave. And it doesn't mean that you failed. It just means that that's not what you want to do for the rest of your life. Yeah, I just had to get over that, I think, in my mind for sure.
And you're happier where you are now.
Right, exactly. So much happier, such a better work-life balance, so much less stress. So it's good.
I'm sure the job is still stressful in its own way.
Yeah.
What's the typical day or week in a wound nurse's shoes from the kinds of patients you'll see? And I know it'll vary based off of facility and the scope of practice they are allowing nurses to have for wound care. But in your experience, what's the wound nurse's version of a day?
Okay. So I'll talk about the one that I worked in full-time. It's a level 2 trauma center. It's got, I don't know how many beds, a lot. got a lot of surgeries going on. It's busy. There's a lot happening. It is the busiest as far as complexity of patients, but not necessarily the busiest as far as number of patients. Mm. That is different than if you were seeing just a crazy number of patients. Not that they're easy patients, but not as difficult or complicated. Yeah. A lot of the very complicated cases get sent to this facility from the other ones if they can't manage them there. A normal day usually looks like coming in at the beginning of your shift. And in this department, one of the wound nurses, because there are multiple, and again, that's unique. Sometimes smaller hospitals or hospitals who just haven't prioritized pressure injury prevention a lot will have maybe one wound nurse or two on a given day, but we would have between 2 to 5. So it's a lot bigger of a department than what's normal, I would say. But again, we get a lot of complicated cases. So it's definitely we use all of those bodies for sure. But coming in, we would have one person, like a charge nurse would on the floor, making the assignment for the day. We try to divvy up patients based on where they're located, the complexity of it, how many people you need to coordinate with to be that patient, and then the number of patients. And then we would adjust it if we needed to, like one person knew a certain patient better than the other, those types of things. And then in the morning, it's mostly in the office, looking through the chart, doing a thorough chart review, reviewing photos, reviewing progress notes, you know, looking at what has changed since we've seen them last, and then coordinating with the nurses to see those patients in person throughout the day and trying to see as many as you can in the morning hours, because as new consults come in throughout the day, we try to see those patients that day if possible. So the rest of the day is coordinating visits, seeing patients, ideally with the nurse and possibly with the physician as well. We work pretty closely with a lot of the plastic surgeons, trauma surgeons, general surgeons. So if it's a big abdominal wound with a fistula in it, you know, there's stool coming out of the wound. A lot of times we're meeting with the general surgeon who did the surgery, just so we're all on the same page. And then the plastic surgeon, after they've done a flap or preparing it for skin grafting, we'll meet with them to be on the same page. We also have physical therapy that does mist therapy. It's an ultrasound spray is the, that's not a great way to say it. Mist. That's why they call it a mist therapy. But it's basically delivering ultrasound to the wound bed, and that helps it to heal faster and helps to breed any necrotic tissue. It does a lot of great things. It sounds like voodoo. It sounds like voodoo magic. Cause you're like, what? And you see it in person. It's like literally spraying it with saline. It looks really not impressive, but it's really amazing. That's beside the point. So we're coordinating with anybody in the care team that needs to be a part of that assessment, and then adjusting the treatment plan as is appropriate, whether they're getting ready to be discharged or transfer, or the wound has changed, you know, adjusting all of the treatment plan so that it's the best for the patient, for the staff. By the end of the day, about 30 minutes before the end of the shift, I like to try to be back in the office, wrapping that stuff up, doing all of the other emails, that kind of things that, you know, you have to get done, but are not direct patient care. So that's, I'd say, a very typical day. However, there are other roles that we have, other things that we do that don't happen necessarily every day, like education with the bedside nurses. That's one of the reasons that a hospital can justify the cost of a wound nurse, because we don't really provide a billable service to the hospital as far as the wound care goes. There's some things that they probably could bill, but it's not going to cover the cost of a wound nurse. Yeah. And so the way that they justify the cost of the wound nurse is by decreases in pressure injuries in the hospital. A lot of it happens organically when we're on the unit, like, hey, I noticed so-and-so doesn't have their heels offloaded in bed. You know, they just had a hip fracture. That's really important. Can we put those on them? Did you know that you have those stocked on your floor? In between all the visits, we're doing a lot of education with the nurses. And again, that's how the hospital can justify having us. So we're doing a lot of pressure injury prevention, doing formal education at any continuing education, things that happen throughout the year. In this facility, they have a wound nurse that is designated for each unit. So one wound nurse will kind of cover 2 or 3 units, and it's their job to watch the patterns of pressure injuries in those units, do education when it's needed, coordinate with the clinical nurse specialist or whoever is responsible for education. It varies on the unit based on the needs. You know, the trauma unit is very different than the cardiac surgery unit. So a lot of that happens throughout the day. That's what I'm referring to with the emails and things. So there's an education piece. There's also a direct patient care piece, which I really enjoy having a little bit of both. I think if I was completely away from the bedside, I would be very sad. I love to work with patients, but it is also fun to work with the nurses and to be a resource to them. We get stopped in the hallway all the time. People ask questions, which is really cool. And I like to be that person who is at the bedside, who understands, you know, from a nurse's perspective, what's going on, which I think is a problem with management sometimes, is they're so far removed from what's actually happening, what it's actually like to take care of patients. So you get a little bit of both of those worlds in that role. And I think it's a good balance of the two. I really enjoy that.
I think it's crucial to have those wound care nurses. I know when I've had them at my facility that I really value what they know, because I don't have the bandwidth to know every single cream and medication and type of dressing versus packing versus wound back. Like, I know basics enough to be able to be like, if it's bleeding, put gauze on it. Like, if there's a pressure injury, we need a foam dressing to help keep that from getting more pressure. And like, I know those things, but then like Therahoney comes up and I'm like, wait, we're putting honey on a wound? And that's like, in my mind, I'm like, that's a food product. How is that helpful? Instead of like, and you would think it would make it worse, but it makes it better. And to have that dedicated department who is abreast of all the new technologies and the research that's coming out, to then be able to be like, this is actually what's best for the patient. And to have that bridge to be like, I'm the expert, and have you talked to the doctor, instead of you telling me, or me thinking that, oh, I think I need MetaHoney, but I'm going to tell the doctor, and the doctor's like, what are you talking about? But then you do it, and the doctor's like, oh yeah, sure. Like, it's just that level of expertise that as a regular floor nurse taking care of patients, we just don't have the time or bandwidth to do. Even that example of offloading heels. We're so busy, sometimes you don't even realize that they're not offloaded.
It's catching it just in time. You know, they talk about just in time, education, intervention, all those things. If we can catch one patient a day, hey, can you put a sacral Mepilex on that patient? Hey, can you offload their heels? Make sure they're being turned. It looks like they scoot themselves off the pillows after you reposition them. You know, just simple things like that make a huge difference. Because like you said, these nurses are so busy. And it's hard to do everything and be thinking about everything at one time. And so it's good to have that resource and someone who you can ask, or who you can delegate that to.
Yeah. Since becoming a wound care nurse, what opportunities have opened up to you, either personally or professionally, whether it be like the schedule? You mentioned work-life balance.
I think personal opportunities, I'd say just the scheduling for me made a huge difference. With my husband working more of a 9-to-5 job, it made sense for me too as well, because then we had more time together. Mm-hmm. I think that 12-hour shifts are great for some people, but for me, it just didn't seem to work. It's nice to work 3 days a week and have time off, but I've really enjoyed having the evenings available to have dinner with friends, or now that I have kids, spend time with my kids in the evenings and not miss out on the entire day. You know, I can still see them in the morning before I go to work. If it's an 8-hour shift, 7 to 3:30, you can see them before you leave, and they still have the rest of the afternoon when you get home. So that's really been nice for me. And then as far as a day shift regular schedule, that's a game changer. I'm not a person that functions well working night shift. I know some people can do it, and there's people who do it their whole career, and we need people like that, but that's not me. That has been huge for me. And then as far as professionally, it's interesting, because when you do have kind of an expertise, like you're saying, most nurses, they don't have the time to know every single dressing. And even the wound nurses, we don't. There's so many coming out all the time. And I think that's why we've seen an increase in the number of wound nurses that are being utilized, is because just to keep abreast of all the new technology that comes out and the best technology, it's a full-time job. And we're kind of the gatekeepers between what the hospital will utilize as far as wound care and what they don't. They kind of defer to the wound nurses as far as what's appropriate and what's not, and we'll do a full review of everything. So that's been interesting. With that expertise, there are some different opportunities as far as product selection, as far as doing presentations even outside of the hospital and outside of the job. So working with people who have colostomies, you know, any kind of ostomy in the community, we have a support group for those people that is kind of run by and supported by some wound and ostomy nurses. That's a cool opportunity. And then just being a resource to other people. There's lots of opportunities when you have more of a specialized knowledge, you know, when it's very specific, because it's very specific. Wow. You know, I don't pretend to know as much as I did when I worked in the ICU. There are more opportunities for being a resource even in the community, because it's easy to pinpoint that person like, oh, they're a wound and ostomy nurse. If I have a wound or an ostomy question, you know who to contact. There is a lot of community between the wound nurses as far as the quarterly dinners where we get together, and it's usually a rep from a wound or an ostomy's company. They're wanting to pitch their next cool thing or whatever. And because we are the gatekeepers, we are the ones that kind of okay or not okay the products that come into the hospital, they want to talk to us. But then we get to all network together. We get to talk. We get to be a support system for each other. And that's a really cool thing that I didn't expect when I went into this specialty, is kind of that support from the other wound nurses in the area.
I wouldn't have expected that either, because it just seems like they're in the hospital and then they go home and then that's it.
Right. Yeah. I don't know how this meeting started. I don't know whose idea it was. I think it was part of the WOCN like organization, you know, the professional organization, the chapter in our area that started it. But it's a really cool thing just to be able to have people who you can talk to about difficult cases, people that you can kind of share best practices and just hang out with, who understand what it's like to be in your position.
Yeah.
So it's been a really cool thing.
And there's so much you can learn from other cases, because different people have their different perspectives of what the ingenuity of some of the things that wound nurses will do to help a patient when there isn't quite the right solution. So then they have to kind of make one, and then be able to share that with everybody else.
Yeah, I'd say out of all the nursing specialties that I've seen or been around, I think it's definitely the most MacGyver-y type of discipline, because there's never the exact right pouch. There's never the exact right thing that you need in that moment. And it's like, well, I think I could connect these two adapters together and it might work with some foam tape around it to fit to this pouch to drain it, you know, or whatever it might be. And we shouldn't be using things off label, you know, off what they're not intended for. But there is a lot of creativity that goes into it, which is also a super fun aspect of it, because it's challenging you to think outside the box. If you can't use an off the shelf product to solve the problem, then coming up with a unique solution, it can be very frustrating to not have the right thing, but it also is really cool to be able to come up with something just with what you have available to you.
And I know we talked a lot about what makes you excited about wound nursing and a lot of the pros to the specialty. For those nurses who are thinking about it as a possibility or are just curious to know more, what advice would you give to them about getting into the specialty or staying in it, or even if it might not be a good fit for them?
I really love it, as you can tell. So I would say that there's not too many cons, but like everything, there is. So there are some cons that I think it depends on the person. If you don't like the 9-to-5 schedule idea, then it's probably not for you. If you really enjoy night shift, it's probably not for you, because rarely do you have a wound nurse that does night shift. I don't think I've heard of one. I'm sure they exist, but generally speaking, it's more of a daytime. It's a consulting position. So if that's not your cup of tea, if you want to work night shift, if that works well for you, it may not work for you. It might, you know, you could negotiate that with your facility if that's something that is a need, but in general, wound nurses don't work at night. I've seen some that do 10 and 12 hour shifts, so that's still a possibility. Well, this depends on the facility. If you have a facility where there's only one or two wound nurses, there is more of a kind of lone wolf feeling to it. You are working with people, but you're more independent, which can be a pro or a con. Some people really enjoy kind of doing their own thing and having that high degree of autonomy. I would say in the facility that I've been kind of referring to this whole time, because it's a bigger department, bigger wound nurse department, you still get a good balance of people to bounce ideas off of, a good teamwork environment, all of that. But you still have the autonomy because it is a consulting position. You are writing wound care orders. You have a lot more independence. However, you still have those people around you to support you. But if you work in a smaller facility or one that doesn't have as many wound nurses for whatever reason, then it can be a little isolating or lonely if that's not your cup of tea. So I would say that that's not a reason to not become a wound nurse, but just to be aware of that. You know, we have a smaller facility in our system that only has one wound nurse because it's small. And that's not my favorite place to work because I like to be around other people. I like to have another person like, hey, I'm not really sure what to do with this situation. This is what I'm leaning towards, but can you look at the photos with me? Can you give me your thoughts on this situation? But some people really enjoy being on their own, doing their thing and feel confident in that. And so that's just something to be aware of for sure. I really can't think of too many other cons, honestly. The one last con would be the smells and sights. Mm-hmm. If you are someone who, you know, has been working at the bedside and you don't enjoy wounds, don't do it. you have to actually like it, right? You have to like wounds. And not saying I like all of them. Some of them are very gross. And you get used to those sights and smells after a while. But if that's something that just turns your stomach thinking about, maybe not the right specialty for you. There are a lot of gross things, a lot of maggots in wounds, a lot of pus, a lot of just pulling random things you're not quite sure what they are out of wounds. There's some gross things to it. It is objectively not the cleanest or nicest specialty. So just be aware of that. You get used to that. Like I used to gag at certain smells and now nothing I'm pretty sure could make me gag. So you get used to it, like everything. You wear a mask and you put chapstick on and you're fine. But that is something to consider if it really grosses you out.
That is a big thing to consider. Every nurse has their ick factor and sometimes wounds is it.
Yeah, I don't want to do sputum. Nope. Questioning a trach? No, those days are past me. Thank you. Oh.
Well, thank you so much for being on today, Shannon.
Yeah, thank you for having me.
Life is a winding road, no telling where it goes.